Hello, and welcome back to A Method to the Madness, the weekly podcast where we discuss, analyze, and otherwise ponder our favorite films and television. I'm your host, Mitchie Hartnett, and joining me is my usual co-host, Patrick.
Hello.
And for the first time ever, we have our first guest, David.
Crossover episode.
Crossover. This is like the MCU, but with more sex appeal, I hope.
Yes.
With what? You.
Yeah. With more sex appeal.
Oh, yeah. Really?
Yeah. Well, Well, that's true. That big purple head of his.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so David here, we've been doing a bit of collaboration with you, wouldn't you say, Pat?
Yes.
Well, a bit of backstory. Pat and I met because he was producing and helping us with the Arthritis podcast for quite a bit of time.
That's right.
And now he's graduated and he's got a show of his own.
So. Okay. And tell us about that podcast.
Well, we're no longer running it at the moment. We're trying to work out a new format for it. But
right.
The podcast was sort of each week we would break down something from pop culture, whether it's like a movie, a game,
yep.
A TV show, something like that. We would conduct a close reading analysis of it. So I would bring to bear a series of research, and then my co-host Ben would sort of play the interlocutor and kind of rebut some of my statements and claims. And then we had all kinds of guests on. And,
oh, that's cool.
Yeah, we ran it for about 8 years, I think.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Damn.
Eight years. That's a
long time. Just a pretty good run.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now we're sort of working on a new project called Zero Indent, which your podcast is kind of a part of, which is like an online publication for media criticism that is maybe a bit more focused on the way that we experience and the way that we craft media rather than, I guess, like trying to rate it out of 10.
Yeah. Okay.
That's my opening salvo. That's
yeah. So check that out, zeroindent.com, right?
That's the one.
Anyway, before we get stuck into a movie, I'd just like to, well, I don't know if I should do this, but I'm going to anyway. We had a week delay in our last podcast.
Yes.
So Patrick and I apologize for that, but you know, shit happens.
Yeah. Sorry. I was going on a road trip.
Pat was on holiday.
Yeah, I mean,
we never told anyone before you left. You know, you got to apply for your annual leave first.
Yeah,
send it to HR, bro. I'll sign that shit off. Don't stress.
Yeah, to our like you know, millions of loyal fans, I'm really sorry.
Well, I missed it that week. I was like, I thought it was the thing this week, and then nothing happened. And I was happy because I got the thing, so I was fine. I was fine with it.
Yeah. Today it's a particularly exciting podcast, so we are doing La La Land. Because and why it's exciting is because we're actually breaking out of the mold of doing the same 4 years over and over again.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know this, David, but our last 19 podcasts, this is our 20th podcast,
mm-hmm.
they were on films from either 2019, 17, 2011, or 1982.
I was aware of this,
and
yeah.
We somehow managed to consistently stay with those years, and now here we are breaking out of that, so we're doing a movie from 2016.
Exciting stuff.
It is.
So, La La Land is a film directed by Damien Chazelle, starring Ryan Gosling, Emma Stone. They're pretty much the only main actors in it, but I'm going to say John Legend, as well as the legendary J.K. Simmons himself.
For like 2 minutes.
John Legend's in this?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's the band leader that.
Oh, he is. Oh my, I never made that connection.
Yeah, yeah, that's him.
That's
yeah.
How good of an actor he is.
Did you just describe him as high?
What's that? He looks high.
Yeah, he does. That's exactly what I thought as well.
He kind of does. I just thought about that for a second. I'm like, yeah, he does.
That's
does
a weird drive-by. Yeah.
Something about his eyes. But yeah, so we're here to talk about this wonderful film, this musical. Should we start off by going around the table here and sharing our opinions of this movie? So let's start with you, Pat. No, actually, let's go with you, David.
Yeah, let's go with the guest.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, no, really go with the guest. Cab off the rank. Yeah. Okay. Look, the first time I saw this was sort of around when it came out, and it didn't really affect me too much. I just thought it was pretty cool.
Yep.
Watching it the last few times, like I watched it about 6 months ago, and then I watched it again this week in anticipation of this. A lot's changed in my life. Like I've gone through the process of like falling in love and being in a relationship, and now I'm on the other side of that. And it like, this shit hits different now that I'm in that position where I've gone through some of that stuff.
I 100% agree.
Especially like, you know, it was a pretty long-term relationship. Like, you know, it really changes your perspective on the world. And for me, previously, I would have been like, oh, it was kind of glitz and glam. And it was like, you know, it was like a wistful ending where it's like, ah, what could have been, you know. Now it feels way more mournful, I guess, the way that it sort of closes. I felt not a sense of closure, but a sense of like sobriety, I guess, coming out of it. And it really was a Debbie Downer for my Saturday night. I got to be
honest. Oh, really? It brought you down, did it?
Yeah, I just sat there and I was like, man, what could have been?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then I had a whiskey, and I was like...
what the end is about of that movie.
I had a whiskey and I pondered it on the staring out at the sky, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's also about what there was and appreciating what happened, even though
that's
it may
correct.
Be over.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. What do you think, Pat? Would you watch it like a day ago or something?
Yeah, I watched it yesterday. Yeah, man, David, that was a very poignant articulation, and I think my contrast
articulation
is not going to be as meaningful. But hey, man, I love me some bittersweet endings in my movies, and this certainly delivered on that front. I don't know, some tads of things I liked about this film. I love the anachronistic Sound of Music era style, but set in the modern day sort of visual aesthetic.
Wow, I never thought about that. That's
With the
good description.
Well, yeah, you know, at the beginning, it has that filmed in Panavision or whatever. Yeah. And, you know, I think I like how it's deliberately evoking those old timey musical aesthetics, you know. I love the efficiency in its telling. I don't know about you guys, but for me, I really noticed how it cuts out a lot of cliches because it bargains on the fact that you know what's going to happen.
Yeah. You've seen a movie before.
Yes, exactly.
You don't need the sex scene. We got it. They're together. It's fine.
Yeah, yeah. An example is when Mia is auditioning and they clearly reject her, but you don't see her reaction to it. You just see the audition and how despondent the producers are, and that you don't see the aftermath, but you just know what happens from the performances.
Yeah.
You know, it gives you all the information you need. And
Like the silence in those scenes with the staccato cuts where like the cuts are very loud and aggressive, but there's no backing. It's just dead silence or like, you know, the sound of him turning a piece of paper or something.
Exactly.
It communicates everything it needs to about her, like how she feels about it. You don't need her to, you know, be like, oh, how did that audition go? And, you know, someone call her and you get that scene where she's like, oh, it was really bad.
Yes.
You get it. It sucked.
In a lesser movie, there would be a scene where she's crying and, you know, someone consoles her, as you said.
Right.
Yeah, interesting. Okay.
Yeah. What about you, Mitchie?
Yeah, I was pretty standoffish when I first watched it because I do want to talk about musicals because this is sort of technically a musical, and I've never really enjoyed musicals in my life. And man, but like I watched it and then the first opening scene happened, I'm like, whoa, this is a bit too musically for me. It feels like HSM or Sweeney Todd or something. Then the second song happened, someone in the crowd, and Mia goes to the party, and I just, the colors in that scene was just so incredible. Like just the way everything was shot, like the whole bit when they're singing in their apartment is all in one shot. Then she walks through the crowd at the end and the bloke jumps in the swimming pool and the music swells and the camera again is just all one shot and it's just spinning around and shit. And I'm just like, whoa, this is like, bar the fact that it's a musical, even if it is a musical, like it just incredibly directed. And it just hooked me from that point on. I was like, holy shit, this is like, just the production quality of it is just enough for me to enjoy watching it. And then it started to grow on me. And like you said, David, like, you know, the context of love and when you kind of match it to your own experiences, it really brings that out. And and by the end of it, I was like, wow, like I really connected with the movie. The end of the movie was so poignant, so bittersweet, but so like relatable too. You like, you do think about like what could have been, but it didn't bring me down. I kind of thought about it like, well, it is what it is, and I appreciate
that. Makes sense.
What I've experienced in my past, this movie is just amazing. I absolutely love it now, and I just can't get over it. And I listen to the music, and I just, you know, I'm always like whistling one of the tunes from it. It's just, yeah, I love it.
I'm assuming you're related to it hard because you're a bit of a pianist yourself, aren't you?
Yeah, and that's what I really like, that aspect of it as well, which Ryan Gosling did not know a bit of piano before they started filming this, and they did not use any hand props. He had to learn it all himself.
Really? That's
yeah, amazing. Including
that's
that bit
brutal.
Where he plays it in the bar, you know, the really kind of elaborate part, that was all him, which, you know, as I've played piano before, and like it's not exactly easy, and definitely not easy for someone who's never played before, and they filmed it within a year or something, and he managed to learn it perfectly.
Damn, props
to him. He still gets fired for it.
Yeah, well, he didn't play the set list, did he?
You're fired. How funny was it that J.K. Simmons says that?
Yeah.
So good.
Yeah.
He's in another one of Chazelle's films, right? Whiplash?
Yeah, which I would like to talk about because there's a lot of thematic kind of similarities between this and
yeah,
Whiplash.
We can't get started on Whiplash. We'll be here all day.
Well, why don't we get started on the plot summary, which I don't know who wants to read it.
Yeah, okay, I'll read
Pat's
it.
That's closer.
Yeah, you should read it, yeah.
Okay. So, La La Land follows the story of two LA souls, Mia, played by Emma Stone, a Hollywood cafe barista, and Sebastian, played by Ryan Gosling, a restaurant jazz pianist. Both have specific dreams, namely for Mia, it is to become a Hollywood star, and for Sebastian, it is to open his own jazz bar. Meeting perhaps under serendipitous circumstances, the two quickly become lovers, moving in together and motivating each other to achieve their dreams. Mia writes her own one-woman play. Meanwhile, Sebastian is offered a steady job with a previous band that has achieved significant fame and becomes quickly engulfed touring across the US, leaving Mia alone in LA. The two have an argument over Sebastian's absence from home, and their relationship falls apart. Mia performs a one-woman play, which has a disappointing turnout, and she moves back to her hometown, leaving Sebastian. Due to her performance in her own play, Mia is offered an acting job that will take her to Paris. Due to their now busy careers, Mia and Sebastian agree that their relationship is at an end, but that they both will always love each other, and they part ways. 5 years later, Mia has become the big shot actress she always wanted to be. One night with a new partner, she stumbles across a bar, Seb's, exactly how Sebastian originally envisioned it as. Sebastian is the owner and glimpses her in the audience. There is a pang of bittersweet regret when they both see each other, and Sebastian plays their theme on the piano, which elaborates into a beautiful sequence of the future that never was between Mia and Sebastian. Mia leaves the bar, glimpsing back one last time at Sebastian. They exchange smiles, remembering the beautiful relationship they once shared together. The end.
Hmm.
The she does have a wedding ring on in that last scene, so it is her husband rather than...
Yeah. Oh.
Just by the way.
Well, she has a kid too, so...
Oh, true. I forgot. Yeah. Yeah. Also the... Yeah. You can have a child out of wedlock, Pat.
Yeah.
It's not the 1800s.
What harlot would have that?
No, they wouldn't have, made the movie if that was the case, you know?
No, that's a good point. It's morally...
So had to make sure they were married.
What's the word? Like, morally reprehensible?
That's a joke. I don't actually know if that's true. Yeah, well, I just want to talk about how successful this movie was. So, you know, I'd heard of it, but I never watched it until a few weeks ago. And I didn't even know why I decided to watch it. I think I decided to watch it because being on a kind of Ryan Gosling streak. So, I was like, yeah, I'll watch this. And this is the most successful film in the history of the Golden Globes.
Is that right?
Yeah.
What?
It won seven.
What do you mean by successful?
So he won the most awards and won all of them that was nominated for. Won 7 out of 7 nominated awards.
Oh, okay, right, okay, yeah.
Did that sink in? Like, that's pretty big fucking deal.
Wait, what?
And well,
100% success rate with the nominations, you mean?
How many Oscar things are there, though? Like, I have no context for this. Golden Globes, not Oscars, sorry.
How many Golden Globes are there?
At least 7.
Yeah, at least 7. It's apparently the most successful film in the history of the Golden Globes.
Yeah,
which already is enough in itself. It is also the most nominated film in the Academy Awards, like the Oscars ever, which is a record tied with Titanic and All About Eve. 14 nominations.
Wow.
And it won 6 nominations. It's a darn successful film. Like, it's, you know, like, it's won a lot of awards from 2016, and I'm actually quite surprised, because, you know, I knew it was good, but I didn't know it was this good. It was crazy.
Is its critical success reflected in its commercial success? Like, was it also,
yeah,
like, did it make bank?
Yeah, it wasn't the most profitable film of the year, but it was like the 5th or 6th most profitable, and like, compared to its budget, it made like a shitload of money.
That's amazing.
Its profit was like 120 million or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, I'd be happy if I made a profit of 120 million. So
yeah, that'd be all right.
Versus a budget of like, you know, like not that much. It was a few tens of millions or something like that. Maybe
double that for marketing or whatever.
Yeah, it's overall quite a successful film, and I think that's kind of surprised me quite a lot. And the history behind this movie is that Damien Chazelle, the director, he's friends with Justin Hurwitz, who's the composer for the music for La La Land. They were college mates, and they decided to always have this plan of making a musical together. And the screenplay for this was actually written quite a long time ago by the two of them, back almost in like college. And they were looking to get sponsorship, but they couldn't get it. So in 2010, that's when they decided to go out and do this movie. No one would give them any sponsorship. And people were mainly skeptical because it's a jazz musical.
Yeah, that checks out.
Does it?
Well, like, think about the media landscape at that point. Like, Joss Whedon's Avengers is in a big way. Like,
yeah.
The money-making machines are like your action blockbusters. Musicals that are popular at that time, there aren't really any. The closest you've got is like, you know,
Les Mis.
Thinking like what Emma Stone, yeah, Les Mis. I'm trying to think what Emma Stone was doing. That would have been like around The Help and that kind of era where it was all like period dramas. Like the musical wasn't in, you know, like it wasn't like the cool, it wasn't the, like we hadn't had, you know, Book of Mormon and Hamilton.
Yeah.
And like it hadn't matriculated into the lifeblood of like the nerd zeitgeist. Like, you know, someone who likes Joss Whedon's Avengers wouldn't have fucking thought about a musical twice until Hamilton. And now suddenly musicals are cool.
Yeah, true.
Like there has been this transitionary period where like suddenly they've become an option and accessible and something people are interested in as a result of like these breakout successes.
Yeah.
I mean, that Hamilton's complicated because you have to be rich to be able to see it in the original run, and it's super problematic for a musical about the deconstruction of capitalism. Anyway, not going to get into that now, but yeah, no, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, okay. Like, I mean, that's fair enough. I mean, but they were willing to do it, though, if they were going to so basically, the conditions were they had to just drop the intro scene entirely. I don't know why you'd, like, that's so important. And then they wanted to change Sebastian to a rock musician, and then they had to drop the bittersweet ending, and they would have actually gone with it in 2010. But apparently Damien Chazelle was committed to what he wanted, so he didn't accept it. And then he went on to direct Whiplash. And Whiplash, I watched the other day, and holy shit, it is a fucking good movie.
It's one of the best, like, films ever.
It also won a shitload of Academy Awards as well. But like, it is really good, and J.K. Simmons is absolutely incredible in it. If you haven't seen that, Pat, you should watch it.
All right,
so fucking good.
Wait, have you seen it?
I haven't seen it.
Wow.
Whiplash came out and that was successful, so then he got sponsored for La La Land, and here we are, they ended up making that movie. So he's always kind of had a penchant for like music. I think that's kind of his passion, and that's what I like about his movies. He seems to say a lot about the music industry, what it takes to be a musician, which isn't something that, like, we all appreciate musical scores in film, but we don't really appreciate too much music itself in film. And that's what I love about this director. He's just has a passion for music, and that means a lot.
Well, I mean, you can see the bones of that style in Whiplash, I guess, where
yeah,
that movie is so precise and exacting in its construction of its scenes. And, you know, it's a movie about drumming.
Hmm.
I'm saying that.
I know that much.
Okay, cool. Yeah. But so the percussive instruments are timed with, periodically timed with the cuts.
Right.
Or actions in the movie where, you know, someone puts down a cup or something like that are timed with the ambient sounds of the scene. It's kind of got that Edgar Wright feel of being a very like clicky clacky, kinetic, deliberate piece.
Mm.
And I can see the bones of that style in Whiplash. Mm. And now that I think about it, I didn't realize it was the same guy. It's all clicked for me. I'm like, oh, I get it now. Like, I've seen through the Matrix. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
What, you didn't know Chazelle until like 20 minutes ago when we started this?
No, because I'm not a nerd like you guys. I didn't Google it beforehand.
Okay.
It's not my show. I didn't have to do a 10-page doc to prepare. I just came in feeling fresh about it. You know what I mean?
Interesting. Yeah. I haven't seen Whiplash, but I did notice that same kind of like beat Edgar Wright style editing in La La Land. I always love that kind of confluence of visual and sort of music, you know, like
it's the coordination.
Yeah,
there's no cuts though. That's the thing. Like all the musical scenes in La La Land, like all the dancing and stuff, they're all in one shot. But they still make the camera movement itself match with the music, which is, you know, something that's not easy to do, but they managed to do.
There's a lot of virtual, and I don't know to what I've seen some behind the scenes, so I know a lot of it they did with actual cranes and things like that, but there are a lot of really cool sweeping camera movements in this that I can't tell if it's a virtual cam or real.
Yeah,
you know, there's a scene where they're first dancing on the bench overlooking the Hollywood, and there's this like dip zoom where the camera, like, you know, they're dancing on top of the bench and they're facing away from the camera, and there's this dip zoom where the camera drops down, sweeps through and pans up, and we just see the back of their heads.
Yeah,
and it's like the spectacular camera movement that you could achieve in real life. It's probably cheaper to do with digital effects.
Yeah.
But right. My mind is like, now I know that it's this guy. He probably just built a rig that could do that.
I think he did.
Yeah, he ain't no David Fincher.
He ain't doing that shit. Yeah.
But apparently the first scene was all legit on top of a highway. It was super dangerous, and it was like 40 degrees or something, and like people were prone to falling off and killing themselves. They had to be really careful, and they had like big cranes on it, and they filmed it all in three shots and actually molded it together into one shot somehow.
Wait, so did they dead set, like, stopped an LA highway to
yeah.
shoot this?
Legit. That was an actual highway.
That's the most Hollywood thing I've ever heard, which yeah. is, kind of plays into this movie's themes a lot, I feel.
Yeah.
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 Where I grew up, there was this station called K-Jazz 103, and people would just put on that station when they had a cocktail party.
Right.
And everyone would kind of just talk over it.
I know.
It was,
that's the okay. So I think that's part of the problem is that you can't hear it. You know, you have to see it. You have to see what's at stake. I mean, look at these fellas. Look at the sax player right now. He just hijacked the song. He's on his own trip. Every one of these guys is composing, they're rearranging, they're writing, and they're playing the melody. They're just, and now look, the trumpet player, he's got his own idea. And so it's conflict, and it's compromise, and it's just, it's new every time. It's brand new every night. It's very, very exciting.
What do you guys think of musicals? What's your history with them?
I think the first one I really liked was Little Shop of Horrors.
Yeah.
With... Rick Moranis, I think, is, yeah.
Sounds right.
Yeah. Have you seen it, Mitchy?
No.
Do you know what it is?
Nope.
Sorry.
Rings a bell.
This guy who buys a plant who becomes like this giant monster who eats people. And then...
Yeah.
Actually, you know what? I'm just realizing the parallels with Sweeney Todd about some guy who chops people up. But anyway.
Yeah, it's like musicals have three plots or something.
Yeah.
Sorry, that was mean.
Yeah, the truth is,
I mean, you're not wrong.
Mean. Yeah.
It's probably a parallel between La La Land and Grease or something.
Well, that's why Les Mis and Hamilton were so successful, is they were different. Same with Wicked, even though that's bad. If you like it, you're wrong.
Wicked, what is that?
Wicked?
Yeah.
What's wrong with Wicked?
Mitchy, did you want to explain to Pat Wicked just briefly? Because I'd love to hear your words.
No, you should explain it because I haven't
seen it. It's like...
The music is all right.
Yeah, it's just like a classic reimagining of like a fairy tale, but it's from the villain's perspective.
Ooh.
Bro. It's like Maleficent, but worse.
Okay.
Oh, fuck. Cool. That movie is terrible.
Maleficent 2 is quite good, though.
Wait, was that Angelina Jolie?
It was, inexplicably, yeah.
Yeah.
No one's quite sure about that.
But what's you... Yeah, sorry.
So no, I was just... Anyway, like, I never really had any strong opinions about musicals. I didn't particularly not like them.
You didn't think about them.
Yeah. And even with this movie, like, the fact that it's a musical... Like, if the genre of musical was never articulated, never named, and this would just be like a movie where people break out into song and dance sometimes, like, that is how I see it. It is just like a really kind of stylized drama. And it's, without labeling anything, it's just a very, like, artistically done movie. And I love it for that, yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah.
I mean, my whole background with like musicals is like musical theater, like seeing it in person.
Hmm.
I always wanted to be a theater kid, but I was never talented enough.
Right.
So I instead had to buy tickets to go see other people do it who were better than me, which is a forebearer of the rest of my creative career, but let's not dwell on that too much. But no, so like I saw a lot of musicals when I was younger, and I liked a lot of musical comedians like Tim Minchin and Bo Burnham and people like that, because I kind of came up at the same time as Bo Burnham. But it was Tim Minchin who was kind of my gateway drug into musicals, because he was always posting, this is way back when like you followed people on Facebook, like their fan pages, when people still use Facebook.
Sure, I can relate.
Yeah, Pat's like, I remember that. he would always post like, oh, this musical's opening and this and that. And so I used to go see all these musicals kind of at his recommendation to a smaller extent. And then I just got into them, and like, you know, I don't know anything about music beyond, like, I know a lot about hip hop because it's poetry and that's like kind of my realm. But as far as like any technical understanding of what makes a good musical or not, it's a bit like porn. Like, I know it when I see it, but I couldn't tell you why. Yeah. I just have that, like, I wish I could, but it's not for me type relationship with it, where it's like, I'd love to do it, but instead I just get to enjoy consuming it.
Yeah. Yeah. Musicals are a weird medium. Like, you either have people that hate them or people that love them, but there's no one that's really in between.
Like an antipathy, yeah.
Yeah, like, it's just... And why is that? And it's obviously because the most of the people I speak to about this movie, they're like, oh, I fucking hate it. And I ask them why, and they're like, because it's a musical. I'm like, okay, sure, you don't like musicals. Why don't you like musicals? And it's because people just break out in a dance all the time, like you were saying, Pat, and like... Sure, that's like kind of creative, but people just hate that because it doesn't feel realistic. People watch films and they kind of want to be immersed in emotion or something like that. You know, in this case, it's a romantic movie. You want to be immersed in the idea of love and you know, bittersweet ending of a life that never was. But integrating all this singing and dancing in it kind of like breaks you away from that. And then it really kind of, you know, it's disillusioning. That's why people don't like musicals if they don't like musicals.
I noticed for the first time ever watching a musical that I periodically found some of the music overwhelming.
Right.
For the first time in my life, I was like, oh, this is almost too much for me. Like, I need a... Like,
emotionally overwhelming.
Or, like, sensory and emotionally as well. Like, yep. Both.
Yeah.
Because I think those two things go hand in hand with a musical, which is what you were alluding to before, where people are used to dialogue and action being two separate things. A musical is, like, a blending of those.
Yeah.
Delivered via, like, music, right? Yeah. So, it's like the action and the dialogue are fused together through the medium of like a song, a performance of a song. And it sometimes, like, I kind of get it. Like, I think sometimes it can just, you're like, okay, I need a break. Like, I get it. This is really, I'm really enjoying it. But like, you need to be in the right headspace to consume that much noise, not in a bad sense, but just like in a literal sense, like the amount of information you're consuming is quite a lot at once.
Yeah. No, I see your point. It's kind of, yeah. No, you're right. Like, it is very, But is it, like, any more intense than watching, like, you know, a super immersive film, like, I don't know, like, Interstellar or something like that, which I just watched recently? Like, you know, something that's super emotional in the movie. Like, what's the difference there?
I think density. So, like, Interstellar occurs over a great period of time, both in the chronology of the story and our literal experience of watching it. That's a fucking long Chris Nolan movie. I think difference is La La Land just clocks in it. It's just over 2 hours.
Yeah.
And that first 30 minutes don't really let up. They're quite spectacular in their portrayal of Mia's kind of interactions with Hollywood. They're very bombastic, and then it grows somber through the middle portion.
Yeah.
So I think the difference is like the density of the, like, because action stories have to do this thing where you have to have downbeats, where like you need a scene where something isn't happening.
Yeah.
So you need the scene, the classic, the one I always point to, it's a really easy touch point, is in Avengers Age of Ultron. There's that scene where they go to the farm.
Right.
It's this really smart downbeat before the finale where you get to understand where everyone's mental headspace is at. You get to understand the tensions in the group. But crucially, you have a moment to take a break from the loud noises and stuff.
Mm,
right. And this is, I should clarify, like, I fell asleep during Avengers Age of Ultron in the theater during the Hulk Iron Man fight.
Oh, yeah.
Which one?
Just like, The Hulk and Iron Man, they beef it out. He's in like the Hulk.
That was great. Suit. I love that scene.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, I was like, man, I'm really tired. It's really like bright and loud. I just, if I close my eyes for a second.
Yeah, it's the perfect environment to sleep in.
Yeah and I woke up. Yeah, cinema. Well, because, yeah, and I woke up at the farm. And I was like, oh, this is nice.
You woke up on some farm somewhere. And you're like, wait.
What happened?
Actually, I think I was drugged. So that's my caveat is like, yeah. I'm like your dad, where I'm like, I go to watch a movie and then I fall asleep halfway through. But I think it's a lot to do with like density, and there's not a requirement in musicals to have those downbeats. Sure, there are scenes in this where no one's singing.
For and quite a long time, actually. About half an hour.
I was going to say, there's a really smart middle bit where they do this really well in this movie. Yeah. And I think this is sometimes what musicals are lacking. I know Les Mis doesn't have this, because instead of this, it's got fucking Anne Hathaway belting out her ballad.
And while she's getting raped.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, let's not. It's fine.
All right.
She shaves her head. Moving on. That film's a wild interpretation of that musical. Actually, I saw that musical in person. It's way better than the fucking movie.
Yeah, because I really didn't enjoy the movie.
Also, what's his name? The villain, he smokes cigarettes and rides bikes around Sydney. What's his name? Russell Crowe was an odd choice. They picked a man who can't sing to be in that. Which I thought was just a wild call.
Yeah. You're right. So after their kind of duet singing, you know, how they sing City of Stars together on the piano, which won Best Original Song.
I thought that was a real song. I was like, oh, this surely is a classic.
It's fucking, it's a nice song. Eh? Yeah, it's beautiful. It's real good. Yeah. And after that, there's for about half an hour until her audition, when she sings to the people at the end about her grandmother in Paris. There's no music whatsoever. Like, obviously, there's, you know, a bit of, like, non-diegetic music, but there's not actual musical music. And that's a long fucking time. That's, like, 25% of the movie where we just don't have any music. For a musical, that is huge.
Wait, did you mean the opposite, that there's diegetic music but not musical music?
Sorry, yeah, I might have mixed that up. Yeah,
because
as in music they can't hear, which I always get.
Well, because in a musical, the conceit is that the characters aren't really singing, they're just like expressing their emotions, But like you get to see, like, yeah, you're right. For that 30-minute period or however long it is, you get to see his band playing and him playing, but there's no actual non-diegetic musical music.
Yeah, there's not like, yeah. It's totally just like a normal film for like half an hour.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's interesting. And I didn't even notice that, which I guess speaks to just how well
exactly
this movie flows.
It's not over. Yeah. And that's what is great about this. So if you compare the soundtrack length to the length of the actual movie, the La La Land comes in very low, right? So Sweeney Todd, the soundtrack makes up about 61% of the total length of the movie.
It would.
And then Grease is about 55%, but La La Land is only 35%. It's a 45-minute soundtrack versus a two-hour movie.
That's really interesting.
Yeah. And like, and that's what I love about this, because normally I watch musicals and you just get, like you're saying, David, like, you kind of, it's overwhelming all the singing all the time. And like you said about action films as well, you need time for a break between this shit.
It's and restraint.
That's why it's so good, because there's... It is restrained. Like, it's not over-the-top musical stuff. It's kind of like, it's a normal film with elements of musicals in it, rather than me just acting out a musical on stage, but I'm just filming it and putting it in a film format. Like,
it's like the opposite of a Scorsese movie or fucking Moulin Rouge. Like, it's like cinema of... I don't know, it's like, because, you know, you got like cinema of excess.
Yeah.
Where it's like Jordan Belfort screaming into a microphone for an hour, and you're like, Jesus, all right, stop doing cocaine in front of me. This is like really restrained.
Yeah. And that's why it's great. That's personally why I think this is just such a good musical, at least to me anyway, because it's just, it's film. It's not a musical, it's a film.
Yeah, that's, you know, what I was saying about like, you don't even have to label this as a musical, I think. Well, like it clearly is, but like, I don't know. If there's an apocalypse and aliens find our movies in like 1,000 years, they might look at this and be like, oh, this is an interesting example of what they call movies.
Right.
And that was a weird.
Yeah. That was an odd. we just doing metaphors
That's
now?
Such a weird fucking analogy. What the fuck?
But well, you're right. But I mean, like, you know, musical is like a marketing term because it sets the expectation for your audience of like what to expect in that genre. Like in the same way that sci-fi kind of tells you there are some trappings you should expect. It doesn't necessarily mean that every sci-fi thing is the same.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, I think musical is sometimes belabored in the general kind of discourse of being like this, like, over the top, you know. I just think, like, when people think of musical, they fucking think of Les Mis.
Yeah.
They think of Moulin Rouge. We haven't, like, necessarily developed a great tool set in the pop culture zeitgeist. In the theater discussion groups, don't at me. It definitely exists.
Yeah.
But I think this is just a case of, like, we maybe don't have the language to discuss this stuff in terms of being a film rather than, like, just being a musical.
Yeah. Yeah, yes. That's very true. I mean, what would you think of, like, say, like, Pitch Perfect? Is that a musical?
I would say that's a movie about music.
Yeah, so it's a similar thing, right? But it's just shit.
But the subject matter of that story...
is shit.
It's also bad. It's the subject matter of that story is not music itself, whereas...
it's just fucking shitty college stuff.
No, it's just like, yeah, it's like college drama, and that's fine. If you want to make a movie about that, I got no gripes with that. Maybe make a better movie about that stuff, but I mean, that's whatever. I think maybe crucially with La La Land, it's more that... because it's about music and it's about creative integrity. Like, the fact that it's a musical makes sense. Like, the themes and the medium align.
Yeah.
And that they didn't make it when they were offered a check but change it for commercialization.
Yeah.
Like, that just contextualizes that further. I'm like, the themes of the story line up so well with the medium.
Exactly.
It's a really quite a transcendent thing to find that, where it's like, and also this movie is about not selling out.
Yeah,
I wonder who Damien Chazelle relates to more, Mia or Sebastian.
Ooh.
I wonder if his personality is split between the two characters.
Maybe.
Because between them, they kind of reach a medium in which he probably did realistically navigate through in the film industry. He probably had to sacrifice a bit of his integrity, but also he got to the point where he could make what he wanted exactly how he wanted.
Do you got? Yeah, that's a really interesting
point. Yeah, yeah.
There's another... famous director, and I cannot think of who it is, who the exact same thing happened, where they had to make a bunch of trash before they let them make the thing they... I was the Treasure Planet guys. So Treasure Planet, for those of you in the know, is that Disney like adventure story based on Treasure Island. And the guys that made that did like 8 or 10 other films before that for Disney, before Disney were like, fine, make the movie you want. And they made the movie they want. It was a total commercial flop.
Yeah.
But they made the one they wanted to make because they did the hard yards. And I feel like this is an acknowledgement of that in Sebastian's character, but it's also reflexively saying you can, if you're choosing to pursuing the kind of avenue of Mia, who is like, I guess she develops integrity. I don't know how else you'd describe it. Like, Yeah. She sort of, she finds her artistic voice, but then also manages to find that partner that she's been looking for. Because, I mean, the whole opening 30 minutes is about looking for that person in the crowd. Mm. And she finds Sebastian, who turns out not to be that person, but he is for a while. Whereas Sebastian, as far as we know, is alone by the conclusion of the movie. Like, I think it stands to reason he doesn't have a partner.
Yeah.
Because instead, he's been on the road for 3.5 years to be able to afford to open this club.
Yeah.
So, in pursuing the integrity that Mia accused him of losing, he's, like, sacrificed this other part of his life.
Yeah.
I mean, quite literally with Mia, where he's like, well, I thought this is what you fucking wanted.
So, what do you think he's trying to say then, Chazelle? About music? Or not about music, but about the idea of love versus ambition. You know, you got your career that you need to kind of stick to, your dreams, but then at the same time, you have your love there.
I don't know that he comes to a conclusion. Because if he did, it would be very... We would see it. You know, the ending would be Sebastian's fucking miserable opening his jazz bar. There'd be a tag at the end. There'd be a prologue where we see him going home alone and, like, pouring himself a whiskey and, like, yeah, looking at old photos of Mia. We don't get that.
No.
We get this impression that, for the time being at least, when he sacrificed his artistic ambition to have that kind of love and that relationship,
yeah,
even then he wasn't happy. So maybe it's more about the people than about the societal structures of, like, you should have to forego creative integrity to be successful. Like, maybe it's just that.
Yeah, it's something that he touches on in Whiplash too, like, very briefly. The protagonist in that, the band, like, breaks up with that girl because he wants to pursue his career in drumming.
He literally is like, I can't go on dates, I need to go drum more.
Yeah. It was such
that's
a weird
fucking pop beat. I'm like, excuse you,
you're such a dork, that bloke.
I was like, oh, sorry, you're not actually a teenage boy.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, that's not, no guy's ever been like, I could have sex or play the drums. I know, I'll choose the drums.
Yeah.
What am I supposed to do? Go back to playing Jingle Bells?
I'm not saying that. I'm saying,
scraping,
why don't you
pennies so
take
I can start
what you've
a club
made
no
and start the club? The people will want to go to it because you're passionate about it and people love what other people are passionate about. You remind people of what they forgot.
Not in my experience. Well, whatever, all right? I mean, it's time to grow up, you know? I have a steady job, this is what I'm doing, and now all of a sudden, if you had these problems, I wish you would have said them earlier before I signed on the goddamn dotted line.
I'm pointing out that you had a dream that you followed, that you were sticking to.
This is the dream! This is the dream.
This is not your dream!
Guys like me work their whole lives to be in something that's successful, that people like, you know? I mean, I'm finally in something that people enjoy.
Since when do you care
I don't enjoy
about
it,
being
matter.
Liked? Why do you care so much about being liked?
You're an actress. What are you talking about?
What's your favorite scene from the movie? I'm just curious, like, legit. Or favorite song? I just want to know myself.
You're like, we might cut this out. I just need to know. For yeah. me. This is for me privately.
Yeah.
What's my favorite? I really like the... I was going to say the movie theater, but I don't think that's true.
Oh, the planetarium?
Yeah. Well, no, I don't like that. I liked a bit before that.
Like, more musical bits.
Yeah, I'm just thinking.
Like, you got... Because what you can break down the whole soundtrack into really 6 melodies, which is what I love about it. You got Another Day of Sun, and then Someone in the Crowd, me and Sebastian's theme, Planetarium, City of Stars, and then her audition song, which is kind of like an epilogue song. But... And just... They're all so similar. Like, don't you get kind of confused between the melodies and where it came from? Because, like... I love the last scene because it kind of integrates all of those songs into one epilogue song, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we step through them in their imaginary world where they were together. And it's just such great composing because the melodies are kind of... They represent exactly what they do very well. And, like, it's such a... I love how he uses these, like... If you look at the music, like, he uses these kind of... Constantly using these triplets one after the other, and it moves the music forward, and it's just such amazing, like, composition musically.
Yeah, if I knew enough about music theory, I'd agree with you.
Yeah, I was gonna say, sounds right though.
It's just good shit.
I think the scene I like, the City of Stars, when it's just him singing it and she joins in.
Oh, and did you know he can play the piano, right, Ryan Gosling? Yeah. Very well. Yeah. He can't whistle. So, when he's whistling that bit out on the pier and he dances with that old couple, apparently it's the composer, Justin Hurwitz.
That's so good.
Whistling it for him because he couldn't whistle.
Some people just can't whistle. That's just how life is.
Yeah, but why not?
Have you never met someone that can't whistle?
Yeah, I've met some people, but I just thought maybe they were an exception. I never thought the great and mighty Ryan Gosling would not be able to whistle.
Oh, what can't he
He's human.
Just
Mitchie.
That. Yeah,
he's just got a person.
He's got one flaw. Leave him alone.
Yeah. Yeah. What do you think of the color in this movie?
It is very colorful.
Yeah, it pops up. I think it starts off real poppy and then kind of gets real somber in the middle, which I like. I like that it kind of, the colors reflect the themes.
Mm. Yeah, yeah. I was thinking about the colors just very quickly and like primary and secondary colors, that's all you see in this. So you got red, blue, yellow, orange, purple, green, but like the very base colors of those six. And they mesh them together so well that it never seems off. You know, like you can have bad things put together, but the bad colors put together. But like, you know, the scene where Mia's auditioning and she's like dressed as a police officer 1 minute and then a doctor the next minute.
And oh, and the background changes.
The background changes drastically in color, but the uniform she's wearing is the perfect kind of like antonym to that color behind her. You know, because one of them, they're either primary or secondary colors. They just use like the same six colors over and over again in different shots and it just works so well.
Yeah, yeah. It gives it that old-timey look of the old films.
Is there anything anyone wanted to say?
It's just a really bloody good picture and it always makes me feel a feel, which I cannot say for most movies.
A good picture.
Yeah.
It was a good picture. Oh, shut up, Pat. All right. I was a good picture. What the
I wasn't going to say anything,
but... one for the youngins.
My grandma always says that.
Yeah, okay, you can both fuck off. That's so rude.
Nah, agreed. It is a good picture.
See, he's on board.
Yeah, yeah. No, I agree.
By picture, I mean film.
Yeah, whatever. Whatever, okay.
Yeah. Well, that's our consensus on La La Land. We all seem to like it, I think. Yeah. Yeah. No, this has been a good podcast. I've enjoyed it. Before we finish, recommendations.
Oh,
Have you got any?
Yeah, I don't know, Little Shop of Horrors.
Fuck's sake. This is what he does every fucking podcast.
He doesn't come with anything.
Well, I always forget that we have this segment.
You made it. You made this segment.
That's the Ben of this podcast. This was every week of my fucking life where I'd be like, Ben, recommendations. He'd just stare at me blankly.
Well, because...
I'd be like, you know the thing that happens at the end of our show every week that you've done for the last 5 years?
It'd be easier if we did it how you guys did it in our Friday's way. You recommended stuff you'd been watching. We try to recommend stuff that
like
is
related.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
All right. Well, surely you got one, David.
Crazy Stupid Love with Ryan Gosling and Emma Stone.
Ooh, yes. Oh.
That's a fucking great movie.
I thought that was with Steve Carell.
He's also in it.
Oh, okay.
Do you want to know a fun fact?
Yeah.
About who they were going to originally cast for this?
Oh, I do, yeah.
The guy from Whiplash, whatever his name is.
Yeah.
And your favorite, Patrick, Emma Watson.
Is she my favorite?
Yeah. Okay. You always talk about her.
Do I?
Do you not?
You kind of bring her up frequently.
I'm
trying to remember the episodes of. I'm like, you do bring her up.
I mean, yeah, she's cool. But
that's a weird choice.
She's saying that on the air right now, but fuck, I've heard some good weird things. No, I'm joking.
She's cool.
But yeah, she denied the role because of Beauty and the Beast, but yeah.
Oh, well,
that's
gone.
A mistake in hindsight. Yeah. Oh, that movie's rough.
Yeah.
Yes.
And Emma Stone got Best Actress, so yeah, joke's on her. My recommendation is First Man, because it's the same director, Damien Chazelle, Justin Hurwitz, and the same main actor, which is Ryan Gosling. It's pretty good. Like, it's not as good as these two films, but it's all right. Like, he's definitely, his forte is in music-related shit, not fucking moon landing-related shit, but, you know, I'll give it to him. He had some pretty good music, and have you noticed he loves spinning cameras?
Yeah.
Like, goes back and forth, boom, 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 and it's legit. Like, you see the videos of this poor cameraman, like, in that bit where they're playing in the bar, and it flicks back from Mia to Seb, and the poor bloke's just like, boom, boom, like, going back and forth, and he just looks so knackered by the end of it.
That's brutal.
Yeah. Cool. Where can people find this podcast, Patrick?
People can find A Method to the Madness on YouTube, Stitcher, SoundCloud, Spotify, and iTunes. You can visit our website at amttm.com and follow us on Instagram and Facebook through our links on the website. If you have any questions, queries, insights, or criticism you'd like to send to us, you can at mail@amttm.com. And
nice.
Yeah, what do you want to plug, David?
You can obviously head to the publication zeroindent.com. We touched on that on the top. Also, you can find my book at maynardtrigg.com. It's like kind of a coming of age, kind of low fantasy, low sci-fi story. It's got a bit of horror, a bit of adventure. Mm. It's primarily a mystery. It's got a bit of everything. For the whole family, don't give it to your kids, though.
Can I get a signed copy?
Well, yeah. Yeah, I'll think about it.
Thanks,
very
man.
Very confident.
I'm in the thoughts. That's good. Wonderful. Wonderful. And next time, we'll be reviewing or discussing...
Wait, I could do it. Do you want me to read it out? I could be the, professional podcast.
Yeah, you do it. Yeah. Say it's your recommendation, though. So if it's bad, then it's your fault.
So next week, because the boys are throwing me under the bus, they're going to be covering Brick, which is a 2005 movie by Rian Johnson. It's his first motion picture film that he directed. And it's really elaborate and complicated. And it was made on the cheapest budget of all time, but it super works.
Interesting.
And we have no idea what it's about.
Yeah. Is that what landed him the fly gig on Breaking Bad, you reckon?
No. I imagine that was his great work on Star Wars.
Yes, true.
Somehow. Yeah. Is this a Tenet-related thing? Like, he went back in time or something?
Yeah. We're doing a time loop. Yeah.
Yeah, good one. All right,
there
cool.
we go. That's Brick next week. Tune in for that. Once again, thank you very much for joining us, David. Greatly appreciated.
It's my pleasure.
Love talking to you and... good discussions on La La Land, and hope to see you next time.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me on, boys, and thank you for listening.
All right, see ya.
See ya.